that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean.
In the street. before us. I just pray that as we turn our minds to you and listen to your word, that you will just open our hearts and help us to respond to what you have to teach us through this book. So we pray in your name. Amen.
All right, you can be seated. Kids, you can head out to the church. And we are continuing this month to be focused on the church. Thought it was kind of convenient since we're here as the church. Kind of makes sense, right? I got a question for you. How many of you, and let's be honest, listen, there's no judging. This is like Planet Fitness. Although there is one person on the other machine that has been kind of looking at me funny. Anyway, no judgment here. How many of you made New Year's resolutions? Couple of you? You know you're all chickens. How are those New Year's resolutions going? Yeah, I was going to say not so hot. Because it is, what, the 21st day of the month. If you're doing your New Year's resolutions at this point, you're winning. You're winning, and you're braver than I was, because, yeah, I didn't really set up any New Year's resolutions this year. We started looking at the beginning of this month at the church, and we've been using the text in Acts chapter 2. And I want you to take your Bibles and go there. If you're using a Pew Bible, it's on page 576. If you've got the YouBible app, open that up, and you go to the Events tab, and you can find all the notes for the sermon there as well. But Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47, is the context, at least, that we're using to really understand what the purpose of the church is. There's a lot of misunderstanding about the church in today's society. We have some who view it as this social club where I go and I pay my dues. I like to hang with my friends, and I get, because I've been a long time upstanding member and giver, I get, you know, like the choice seat, which we know the choice seat, right? It's the one in the back. Exactly. You don't want to be in the splash zone. Sometimes we view church as this power thing, right? Oh, I'm the leader of the church. I'm in charge. You must follow me. That's not what it's about. So this morning we're going to jump really from this text in Acts chapter 2, and we're going to look at a bigger scope of who we are as a church. So Acts chapter 2, let me read verses 42 through 47 as we begin. And it says, they. Remember who the they is. These are the disciples who have been following Christ, but this is also those thousands of believers who have come to Christ in the days after Pentecost. It said they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together, had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God, having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. So what we see is the church coming together in unity, living life together, supporting each other, building each other up instead of tearing each other down, holding each other accountable when it needed to be done. And the last verse we saw there was that because of these things, because of their unity and their oneness of mind and purpose, God blessed them, not year by year, not month by month, but day by day. How awesome would it be to live in a church where we see those blessings every single day? That would be phenomenal. We literally could not hold that kind of blessing. Now, we took this text 2 weeks ago, and we connected it to the mission statement of our church. Our mission statement is really summed up in three words, right? Connect, encourage, and equip. And at the end of the sermon 2 weeks ago, I gave everyone in your bulletin notes a challenge to fill out some information, some commitments that you were willing to make in this upcoming year. Not New Year's resolutions, commitments. First was getting devoted or connected to God and church. I do not think that we can make it through this life if we don't have a solid, strong connection with God. In our Sunday school class this morning, we were in our prayer time. We were working through four or five families who are going through great stress right now with loved ones dying or in the process of it. And someone made the comment, I don't understand how they can do this without God. I don't understand how I could get through life with much less tragedy and stress without my connection with God. And then I'm going to take that to the next step, my connection with you, my church family. The reality is you guys are closer to me than my flesh and blood. We live life together. We need to make a commitment to God and the church to be connected. Next, we need to be connected, or to be encouraging each other. One of the things that I love about this church is that we are quick to stand by each other when one is hurting. We are quick to come alongside and to hold them up in prayer to help bear that burden, but also hold them accountable when that's needed. That's part of encouragement, right? You see a friend who's starting to make decisions that are going to lead him down the wrong path. Isn't it the best kind of love to come alongside and help gently, lovingly correct them so that they're back in line with God? And then the third area of commitment was that equipping. We need to be looking for ways to learn ourselves how to be better followers of Christ. But some of us have been gifted with the ability to teach and to lead. And there's an expectation from God, not from me, but from God, that you would use the giftedness that He's given to you and to teach others. What I want to do is take this concept of connect, encourage, and equip, and this passage in Acts chapter 2, and I want to spend some time today talking about what we call core values. Core value is just what it sounds like. It's something that we as a church hold to as fundamental, as foundational to our church. It is something that describes not just what we believe, but it's where we invest our lives. I have a very high view of church. I think that there should be that deep connection. And so you know what? I invest a lot of my time and energy in building those relationships and working through that. And that's why I focus so much really on small groups. You know, and we'll talk about that more as we go. But there's another side of the core value that we have to keep in mind. It's fundamental. It defines, it describes, but it also drives our behavior. We've talked a lot, especially this last year, as we've looked at the Bible, and a lot of time in Ephesians. If we read through God's Word and we see where God says very clearly, this is a change that you need to make, this is something you need to put into practice in your life, and we look at it and we say, man, that is so good, that is awesome, I'm going to check mark that, I'm going to underline it, highlight my Bible, so when I open it, it just sticks out at me, and I close my Bible, I set it aside, and I don't change my behavior, I totally missed it out. So we've got to understand that our behavior should change. Because we're interacting with God, we're interacting with the church. So let's talk for just a few moments this morning about the core values that we as a church have. Number one core value, we value people. I used to jokingly, all right, maybe not jokingly, but when I was in the factory world and I was dealing with customers and vendors who were always upset, it seems like they never called me to say happy birthday or just checking in, make sure you're having a good day. It was always, I want this, or I've got this problem. And I used to say, if it wasn't for customers and vendors and employees, I'd be a happy worker. We kind of get that idea sometimes. If it wasn't for people, you know, this whole church thing would be pretty easy, wouldn't it? Listen, I get the irony there, because there's a lot of you going, yeah, Dan, you don't make this very easy for some of us. Core value number one, we value people. Here's why. People are the heart of the church. They are the heart of God and His kingdom that He's trying to build through us and in us. And it's got to be our desire to lead people to Christ, to help them find that life. That's the connection stage, right? We're trying to help people get connected with God. not for all of the perks that come along with it. Those are great, but ideally, because this is where life is in God. And so we've got to build that connection. Now, I want to take a moment, and I want you to understand, this isn't just, you know, some corporate thing that we're doing. This is biblical. Think about how much God values people. So right back in your mind, Genesis chapter 1, Genesis chapter 2. Here we have the creation account, right? Out of nothing, God makes everything. And in chapter 1, it says, "And God created man and woman in his image." Can you imagine a better template to be made after than God himself? It's not possible. God is ideal. God is perfect and glorious. And we are made in his very image. Understand what that means. That means the person that's very popular that you really like and you get along with and they're just fun to be around and they always buy you lunch. That's the person. Oh yeah, that person's made in God's image. Yes! But it also means that really annoying, bald, chubby guy who's got an office down in the basement and kind of bored on the side, who messes up an awful lot. He's made in God's image. It means that person who's sleeping on a bench at the library, who carries all of their belongings around in a bag, who smells a little funny, who's more loud than I really want to deal with. Made in his image. It's easy for us to value some and to turn an eye to the others. Think about God. He created us in his image. Now, I understand sin has devastated who we are. This is not how life was intended to be. We deal with the consequences of sin, knowing that someday, this is the part of Revelation that I love, the very end when it says that all things will become new. Everything will be restored back to the way it was intended, and we'll all just be right. No more broken hearts, bones, no more sickness. God values people. You look through Genesis chapter 3. Adam and Eve, they're in the garden, right? Everything's perfect. They've got all of the things that they need in one room. Don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So, yeah, let's go have a picnic under the tree. Let's eat from that tree. And from that very moment, sin comes into the world. Because of their intentional disobedience, there's a separation that occurs that we're dealing with today. But hidden in there, in Genesis chapter 3, we see this great promise where God says, "I will make a way for the relationship to be restored, for us to be right again." And we look through the rest of the Old Testament, and you know what we see? Countless events where God is working in the nation of Israel, as well as just the world in general, to bring people to the point that the Messiah is going to come. He's going to bring healing on a scale that we cannot even imagine. God values people. Of course, we know who that Messiah is, Jesus Christ. You think about the way he values people. Our small group Bible studies are in John chapter 1. So take your Bible, turn with me to John chapter 1. Here in this chapter, we begin to see the deity of Christ laid out. We begin to see just who Christ is. It's page 560 in your pew Bible, if that's what you're using. But in John chapter 1, we start out with, "In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. And the Word was God." The word "Word" is referring to Jesus Christ. We set up this fact of who he is and where he is. He is with God. His deity there. Jump down to verse 9. Jesus here is referred to as the true light, which gives light to everyone who's coming into the world. 10, he was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born
not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. Verse 14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We've seen His glory. Glory is of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. How much did Jesus value mankind? He became one of them. The Creator stepping into the creation with one purpose, that we might know Him and that we might believe. He showed how much He values us every day. You look through the Gospels and you see numbers of accounts where he not only healed the sick and got, you know, hearing for the deaf and sight for the blind, but He actually like stopped and talked with people. It's really easy. You're going through a big city and there's a homeless person, or they've got a sign and they're begging for money or for food. It's really easy to roll down your window and give them a buck and then move on. Jesus didn't do that. And there's a reason. Jesus could have come, and we see many times He comes and He takes care of the physical problems, right? He heals them. But He deals with them spiritually as well. Because as great as our physical need is, our spiritual need is so much greater. He built relationships with the prostitutes, the lepers, the poor, all of those who have been rejected by society. He focused on. That's a lot of value. Of course, the greatest example of that we see is His death on the cross. The beautiful thing about His death is that He did not stay dead. He resurrected from the grave. And in doing so, He conquered death. He conquered the grave. He gives victory over sin. That's how much He values people. His desire was that we would be right with the Father. And the only way that that could be accomplished was for Him to step in and die. And in dying, make us conquerors through Him. And that's what He did. God valued people so much. And we claim, as Christians, right, to be followers of Christ. You're there in John 1. Go a few pages to John 17. I know I've got you moving around a lot today, but I don't normally do that, but I'll try to keep you awake. In John chapter 17, Christ is with His disciples there in the upper room. This is just hours before He's going to go out to the garden. He's going to be betrayed by Judas, one of His own. He's going to be arrested. He's going to be tortured. He's going to ultimately die on the cross. And in any of our minds, if we knew this is the last opportunity that we have to share with the disciples before something really traumatic happens, you know, we're going to lay down like the most important thing that we can and hope that they get it. And that's what Christ does. John chapter 17, look at verse 18. Now this is a prayer. Christ is praying to the Father, and He's going to bring the disciples into it. They're listening to this. Verse 18, as You, Father, sent Me into the world, so I have sent them, the disciples, into the world. And for their sake, I consecrate Myself that they may be sanctified in truth. Verse 20, I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in Me through their word. That's us, ultimately, the church. He's praying for us. Verse 21, that they may all be one, just as You, Father, are in Me, and I in You, that they also may be in us. So that the world may believe that You have sent Me. The glory that You have given Me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as We are one. I in them, You in Me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that You sent Me and love them even as You love Me. Do you see a thread going through there? Christ is praying for one thing specifically. Unity. It's this whole, you know, Father, You and I are one. We have this relationship that is so knit together. It's so intimate. It's just so real. And I want my followers, I want the Christians, I want the people at Mayville to have that relationship with each other and with God. And my prayer, Lord, is that they would just be so tight that it would be real. And what was the whole purpose behind that? So we'd feel better? So we'd have someone to help us, you know, move? Hey, you got a truck? Oh, the whole point. Tail end of verse 23. So that the world may know that You sent Me and love them even as You have loved Me. The whole point of unity, the whole point of love in this setting is so that everyone in that setting would see Christ living in us. That's how much God values people. Now, we said that values have to drive behavior, so let me give you the value that I want to see coming from this, or the behavior out of it. We need to love as Christ loved. Now, think about that. Think about what it means to love as Christ loved. Christ loved in many ways that on the surface would seem to be impossible for us to love. Let me give you a couple key words. You can just jot these down. The first way Christ loved, it was very obvious. When Christ stopped, when walking through Jericho to talk to that little man, that tax collector named Zacchaeus, and he took time out and realized, and the passage said he was going through Jericho. He wasn't going to stop, but then Zacchaeus said, "Hey, Jesus." And Jesus said, "You know what, I'm gonna go to your house for dinner." In front of everybody, Zacchaeus was a traitor. He was a thief. He was everything negative in society at the time. And Jesus said, "I'm going to go with him." How willing are we to be obvious in our love? Some people, it's a little bit easier. Christ's love is very obvious. Next, we see Christ's love was complete. Yeah, I mentioned this already, but when Christ came and he healed somebody, many times Scripture records for us this statement or this concept of I've given you physical healing, now go and be correct, be pure spiritually. He was always concerned about faith. He was always concerned about pointing people to Christ. Sometimes we love people for that motivation of, well, I may need them later. I may need some help from this individual. So you know, if I take care of my guys who are electricians, then when I start throwing sparks in my office, I get a free house call. There's always that scratching of backs we're looking for, right? Jesus wasn't like that. I'll scratch your back later. Christ wasn't like that. He was concerned about people and he loved them completely. We see that his love was sacrificial. How many times does it appear that he changed his plans in order to meet and to minister to people? Greatest sacrifice again. Death on the cross. So that we could live. In John 13, which is Christ still at the upper room here, he lays out this statement to his disciples. He says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you." That's the behavior that we are supposed to see. And this is why we say that this is a core value in this church. We must value people because Christ values people. Second core value. We value the Bible. Valuing sound biblical preaching and teaching. I listened to a lot of podcasts today. I love having my headphones in when I'm at the gym. I know, I keep saying I go to the gym. I really do. They've got really comfortable chairs in the lobby. And I sit there and watch everybody work out. It's great. Great sweat and so on. As I'm there, and even in my office, I'll listen to podcasts where I'm listening to some really powerful, great biblical scholars, and they're just challenging me to grow in the Word. But I've got a couple of these podcasts that I really like to listen to, and not because I'm learning theology from them, not because I'm being challenged in my walk with God, but because I'm hearing what other scholars are saying. These would be in the camp of the liberals, if you want to use that word. I don't like that word because it's got so much baggage today. But they have a very different view on the Bible. I believe that the Word of God was just that. It's the Word of God. These teachers will tell you that the Bible's not inspired by God. It's just an interpretation of God. Which means that, you know, we can take this Word of God and we can interpret it based on our experiences. We can interpret it based on our feelings. And you know what I found to be two of the most unreliable things outside of the Chicago Bears and the Buffalo Bills? My feelings and my understanding. Here's the here's what I believe about the Bible. Here's what we believe as a church. First of all, we believe that the Bible is a primary means that God uses to communicate to us. This book spells out very clearly who God is, what He expects of us, how we can please Him, how we can serve Him. I believe that this provides an authority in our life. I love the phrase absolute truth. Many people today don't like that. Oh, don't tell me your truth is right because that contradicts my truth and what I want to do, and therefore, you know, I'm just going to ignore that concept and I can just go and justify whatever I want. I want a source of absolute truth in my life. Because that allows me to go, not me, I'm just doing what I was told. I learned that growing up in factories. I want to know how to please God. I want to know what God expects of me. And if there's no such thing as absolute truth, it's like trying to hit a moving target. I believe the Bible clearly communicates to us God's authority over us, His love for us. It's all there. And I will say, I believe that the Bible is inspired by God. That means I'm not allowed to just come in and say, well, you know what, I don't like that verse, so I'm just going to take my black highlighter and cross that one out. Or I don't like this entire page, so I'm just going to rip that one out of my... I'm not allowed to do that. I'm not allowed to come and pick and choose. And sometimes, you know, that puts us in difficult situations. We talked about that last week in the annual meeting about the different views that the world takes on what God has called sin. And we struggle sometimes to stand up for the truth. I believe the Bible is how that is communicated to us. And of course, we have the Holy Spirit. We have God Himself present in our lives as children of the King that allows us to interpret. Because listen, some of this is pretty simple, pretty straightforward. Our kids get it. And some of it, it's a little bit tougher. But God provides the wisdom. I believe the Bible is God's word to us. So here's the behavior. We need to know and obey. Now, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but there's many people in this room today that would say, I am a follower of Christ, I am a Christian, and I want to do what He wants me to do. Well, guess how you find out what that is? It's in the book. You read the Bible. God wasn't messing around. He wasn't saying, hey, I'm going to make this tough for you. He's making this as easy as possible for us to simply open up His Word, to read it, to understand it, and to obey it. Now listen, I'm not going to tell you the Bible has an answer for every little question that we come up with. It's not going to tell me who to marry. It's not going to tell me where to live. It's not going to tell me what job to take. But it is going to provide foundational rules, a concept for me to follow. Will this person that I'm interested in marrying, will that take me to God or pull me away? Oh, now I have some clarity in how I answer that. This job, if I take this job, is it going to help me grow in my walk with God? Is it going to give me opportunities to bring other people to Christ? Now that sounds silly on one level, to take all of this and run through this whole filter of God. Does God really care about where I'm at? I think so. I think that's important to Him. And I know what's more important is that when we see His Word clearly describing something to us, that we follow it. So many people come to me and say, I'm not sure what to do in this area. You know, the Bible's not real clear. I've been praying about it. I'm not seeing clear. I'm not finding, you know, the answers. And my first question is, well, where are you at in your walk with God in the other areas of your life? Those areas that are very clear. If you're not obeying God in the easy things, it's going to be tough for you to obey God in the hard things. If we claim to be followers of Christ, we have to know this Word. And we have to take the next step. Our behavior has to change. We have to obey. Psalm 119 is a psalm that has a ton of statements on the Word of God. Let me just give you a couple here. Verse 9 through 11. How can a young man or woman keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart, I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I've stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. The psalm says that God's word helps us to live a holy life. When we know God's word, we're better equipped to make the decisions that honor Him, to do the right thing when the stress level is just insane. Psalm 119:105. Familiar. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Your word a lamp to my feet and a light to my back. I've shared this story before, but we were at Bethany Camp for a family week one time. And the kids were all down by the paintball range, which is kind of off from the camp itself. And I got dropped off on the main road, and there were no lights, and my phone was dead. Now, of course, I realized in the back of my mind there's like 60 kids running around with flashlights, and if they knew I was coming, every one of those lights would go off, and they'd be planning some kind of sneak attack on me, because I had three boys involved. I stumbled in the dark, and what would have been like a 4 to 5 minute walk probably took me 10 to 15 minutes, because it was a whole lot of, right? Kind of like when you get out of bed, you don't want to turn the lights on, get in trouble with the spouse, you stumble. And the Bible says very clearly, listen, the Word of God will illuminate our path. It will show us the safe way to walk, and it will take away the fear that comes from the dark. But we have to know God's Word. Our third value, we value spiritual transformation and growth in every member. I come across Christians all the time, hey man, I am so thankful that God came and died for Christ, and my sins are forgiven, and I'm not going to hell anymore, and when things get tough, I've got someone I can pray to. And I say, man, that's awesome, I'm glad to see another brother or sister. What are you doing? How are you growing? Well, I'm not really worried about that. Okay, so you claim to be a follower of Christ, but you're not willing to put the effort and the change into your life to grow. We're familiar with the Apostle Paul. The book in our Bible called 1 Corinthians was a letter that he wrote to a series of churches in the city of Corinth that he had planted 5 years earlier. And in chapter 3, let me just give you the Pruitt's paraphrase here. He writes to this church and he says, listen, you know what? When I was out there 5 years ago and we were planting these churches, I was introducing you to Christ. I was spoon-feeding you. I was giving you the milk, the easy stuff. We were chowing on Jell-O. Because you couldn't handle the meat at this time. But now we're 5 years later, and you should be eating steak. You should be eating ribs. But you're still stuck on mashed potatoes. Listen, I love mashed potatoes, but you know what? I want the meat. And Paul's saying, you aren't growing. And this is a problem. I've got the word transformation underlined there. There's a reason for that. In Romans chapter 12, Paul uses that word transform. We're familiar with these, but let me read my appeal to you, therefore, brothers. By the mercies of God, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Now by testing, you may discern what is the will of God, and acceptable and perfect. That word, transform, means to change from one form into another. Think about that caterpillar. It turns into that butterfly. How many of you kids have dug the caterpillars in your classes? How many of your caterpillars actually lived? You're miles ahead of me. I don't know why, I never lived. But that little caterpillar, that worm with legs, goes into that cocoon and it comes out totally different, doesn't it? That's the concept. We are to be totally changed, right? Because of our relationship with God. So the behavior that we're after is growth. It's to become mature disciples. Go to Ephesians. Last passage for today, 6:18 in your pew Bibles. Ephesians chapter 4. We're going to be back in this book here in a couple weeks. And you remember what Ephesians is all about, right? It's all these identities. It's all these names that we have of who we are in Christ. And in chapter 4, verses 11 through 16, Paul's laying out some fundamental stuff again for the church. And he begins by saying, listen, I'm giving people in the church specific gifts. Verse 11, he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. Here's the purpose, verse 13, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That's a pretty high bar. I'm giving you these gifts. I'm equipping you as a church. I'm helping you get connected with each other so that you can become more like Christ. All right, moms, think back with me. Remember the day you brought home your firstborn child from the hospital? You were so clean and quiet, not so much anymore. Remember what you did, right? You came home and you took that child and you put him on the couch or her on the couch and you said, all right, this is the living room. This is where we watch TV. And over here's the kitchen. In the kitchen, you'll find the fridge. And anytime you're hungry, just go. Your formula will put it down a little low for you because you're kind of short. But it's there, and it's available for you. And just, you know, the bathroom's upstairs. Put the lid down when you're done so you don't miss it, Mom. We did that, right? Of course not. They're not capable of taking care of themselves. But when you've got the 9-year-old, there's some expectations, right? Why? Because our children are supposed to mature. And I suppose to, in quotes. There's an expectation in our life that as we are transformed, we will grow to be more mature in our walk. We will grow to be more and more like Christ. That's the bar that's laid out for us. Look down at verse 14 there in Ephesians 4. Here's the purpose again. That we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by the waves, carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into Him who is the head, who is Christ. We value spiritual transformation because the Bible says we must become like Christ. It's a pretty simple value. Three core values today. Three desired behaviors. And the big question that we have to ask ourselves is how well are we as a church and as individuals meeting these requirements, these core values? And the proof of whether or not we are meeting these values will be evidenced in the behaviors by which we live. If I say I value people and treat them like garbage, I lie. If I say that I value the Bible and yet I don't spend time in it and I don't listen to it and I don't obey it, I've got an issue. If I say I value spiritual transformation, but small group is a little hard to get to. Am I really valuing these things? Back in my factory back in Michigan, I had a guy working for him. His name's Ryan. He's a pastor today. Love this guy. But I remember one day he came to me. He was upset. Decisions the company had been making didn't line up with his view of how it should be done. And so he was upset. He came to me just sputtering. And I'm like, man, what is the problem? He's like, you know what? And he kind of expressed it. And my people knew, if you come to me with a problem, you better come with a solution. We got to work on both sides of this. And so he goes, but here's what we got to do, Dan. He goes, this company needs a mission statement. So I went over to his desk and opened up the drawer and pulled out this binder. Mission statement. I opened it up and read it. He goes, oh, okay. Well, you know, the problem is the mission statement's not enough. We've got to have core values and all that. So I flipped the page. He was getting a little frustrated. But then he said to me, Dan, you know, we can write everything you want down on a piece of paper. But if we don't communicate it to the people, that's where we fail. So I went to my desk and came back with the training logs that he had signed over the course of 5 years with his signature and date on it. It's not enough for us just to say, hey, we value people. We value the Bible and we value growth. It's not enough for me to sit up here and preach this and say, hey, this is how your behavior should be. You have to put these things into practice. All the training, all the teaching in the world is worthless if you don't choose to follow what God has done. We have a clearer vision now, I think, of what God is desiring for us to do as a church. And as I mentioned earlier in the service, this is going to be a year of stretching and of growth and of greater faith. And I'm already praising God for the way He's going to show Himself to be faithful and competent in our lives. But I will guarantee you this, there's not going to be a Brinks armored car stopping outside the front door saying, here's your money. Here's the people that you need. Here's the resources that you're looking for. That's not how it's going to work. And I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not going to sit up here every Sunday and preach about money and resources. And that's not what it's about. But if we can consistently talk about the fact that we need to value people's cross money, love them as Christ loved them, and we need to value growth, we need to value the Bible, and we need to be willing to be transformed and be uncomfortable once in a while, because we're following Christ, He will take care of the rest. He's our God. He loves us, but there is a clear expectation for us to be obedient and to follow Him. So if we continue into this year, that's the mindset that we have to have. And I hope you're ready for that. Let's stand. Let's close in prayer. We'll have a praise and lead us one more. Father God, we thank you so much for who you are and for what you've done for us, and the way that you are blessing. God, I'm going to just lay it out. I want to be that Acts 2 church in the sense that day by day we are growing, that we are seeing your presence, not just in the number of people sitting in our pews, but in the number of lives that are being changed, the behaviors that are being aligned with you and your will and your expectation for us. God, help us to keep ourselves focused on the mission that you've given to us, to go into all the world and preach the gospel and make disciples, teaching them to obey. As we stand here next January, Lord willing, we look back on this year and we're just going to shake our head in amazement at how you've provided many times in spite of us. And God, we will give you the glory every day from now until then and beyond, because you are a great God who loves us deeply. Thank you for that love, Lord, in Christ's name. Amen. mentioned all those things from Ephesians that we're going to be getting back to here in a couple weeks, maybe even a little bit next week. When you go out that door today, love as you have been loved. Live a life that reflects growth and maturity in your walk with Christ. And if you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, today is the day. Make that decision. Pull me aside as we walk out. I want to sit down and explain to you what it means to know beyond any doubt that you are with God. Father, as we close this morning, I thank you so much again just for who you are and what you have done for us. Lord, as I look around this room and I see so many of the lives that even in this last year have been so changed, not because of who we are, but because of who you are in us. God, help us to live like children of the King. Help us to reach out to this world with the good news of Christ and everything that we do. Lord, we pray that you would keep us safe this week, but above all, keep us in your will, and that we would be quick to see those who need you, provide that information for them and that love. Bless us. Bring us back soon. In your precious name, amen. God bless.